Today I am in southern Arizona, and I am looking for the giant desert centipede, the largest centipede species in the United States, and one of the largest species of centipedes in all of North America. The adults of this species are not super reliable to find under ground cover, but my goal today is to find at least one adult, which should be doable. Oh, nice. We have a mother Diplocentra spitzeri and her young. Very cool. This brood of scorpions is a little bit on the small side. It seems to be between 5 and 10, but Diplocentras can have over 15 scorplings. And of course, since these are moving off of the mother, they are second instars. And what you see stuck to the tail of the mother and her carapace, those are molts from when the scorplings were still first instars. Certain scorpion taxa are more prone to having these molts stick to the mother than others, perhaps due to varying levels of granulation on the cuticle, as well as differences in secretions. At the size that these are right now, as long as they haven't left this little burrow, they'll occasionally hop back on the mother's back. I've only ever seen a handful of mother scorpions with the scorpion still on the back, but the last time I observed this was also with Diplocentra spitzeri, which is this scorpion here. While some scorpions in the region will remain a cream color up until the final molt, these ones gradually darken with each molt until they look like the mother here. Oh, wow. A thread snake. This is the first time that I've ever found one under a rock. This one is either Rhina dulcis or humilis. I have to look at the head. I can't really show you since these never stop moving, but this looks like it's a Rhina humilis. Rhina humilis, which is the one that we have here, is the western thread snake. And Rhina dulcis, the other one that I was mentioning, is the Texas blind snake that also lives around here. It's difficult to explain the difference in scalation on the head between the two if I don't have them side by side. But in short, these Rhina humilis have only one scale on the top of the head between the two ocular scales. Meanwhile, Rhina dulcis has three. Neither of these snakes are too common out here, but they seem to be encountered in similar numbers. I've never seen the Texas blind snake, but from what I understand, it's really quite rare to find these western thread snakes under rocks and other debris. Meanwhile, the Texas thread snake is fairly reliable to find underground debris, but not here in southern Arizona. Of these two species, this western thread snake that we have here is the smaller one. But even so, the one that we have here is not full grown. I would say it's about a little over 2/3 grown. Whoa. Okay, here's our first one. I don't have very good footing. Here it is. Here's our Scolopendra heroes, an adult giant desert centipede. In addition to being called the giant desert centipede, these are also called Sonoran desert centipedes, among a few other names. The one that we have here is certainly sexually mature, but it is actually not full grown. In fact, the one that we have here can put several more centimeters on before it has reached maximum length. As I said earlier in the video, this is the largest species of centipede that can be found in the United States, and very near the top of the list for all of North America. Their large size allows them to eat vertebrates, something that other centipedes in the region typically don't do, and these vertebrates can include toads, lizards, snakes, and the like. These can also be quite opportunistic, eating things like roadkill and Pizza Hut's discontinued spicy garlic wings. And they do also feed on the juices of fallen prickly pear fruits, especially ones that are overripe. One other thing that should be noted regarding their diet is they also feed on other Scolopendra species, though I'm not sure if they're cannibalistic or not. Something that's fairly interesting about these centipedes, though they are fairly nocturnal, these are one of the most cathemeral species of Scolopendra in the world. But for now, I still haven't seen a single one during the day. If you're wondering about the bite from the species, I can't tell you much about it because I've only ever been bitten once by an adult, and it wasn't a full envenomation. Incidentally, this was less than 2 weeks ago. All large Scolopendra heroes that I've ever handled in the wild have been fairly docile, like the one that you see here. Down here on the ground is a very well camouflaged grasshopper. This is the Chihuahuan lubber grasshopper, Phrynotetix shivavensis. These are found in Arizona, New Mexico, Texas, Oklahoma, and Mexico. As you can tell, they are highly cryptic, Instead of having distinct morphotypes, these exist on a seamless spectrum of variability. In other words, they're capable of having virtually infinite appearances in terms of patterns, and there's a very good reason for this. So ordinarily, you might think that individual subpopulations of this species across their range have undergone microevolution and have all diverged slightly to match the appearances of the rocks that they live on, but there's actually something else going on here. Basically, these are a very good representative species for what's called phenotypic plasticity. What that means is that these are responding to their environment over the course of their lifetime in such a way that they can camouflage on the rocks of a very specific location. This means that, for example, if you took a nymph from New Mexico on white rocks and placed it here on the redder rocks to develop into an adult, it would very likely end up looking just like the one that we have here. Similar to this, if it wandered off nearby and the rocks were a different color, it would match those instead. To be clear, this is not an example of adaptive camouflage. This process does take several molts to take full effect. It might be difficult to see at first, but we have a Diaphoroma arizonensis stick insect here in this mesquite. And these stick insects are commonly known as the Arizona stick insect, and this one is an adult female. At first glance, it might look a little bit generic, and at second glance, it will still look generic, probably because it is. Morphologically speaking, these don't have too much going for them. But these are fairly variable across their distribution, and depending on the population that you find one in, they can actually look quite nice in terms of color, many being green or even bluish. But this is more true for the males. Other scrub-inhabiting phasmids are not too variable, especially ones like the Parabacillus hesperus that is sympatric in this area. There's actually one of those down here in the grasses next to me. Anyway, these Arizona stick insects are predominantly found in northern Mexico and Arizona, and potentially in the southwestern corner of New Mexico as well. The genus that they belong to, Diaphoromera, is, I believe, the most diverse in Arizona for Phasmida, and among them, this one is the most common by a substantial margin. Oh, nice. We have a second Scolopendra. Here it is. Obviously, this centipede is smaller than the last one, by far, and in my experience, it's been much easier to find ones of these size as opposed to the large adults. And this is especially true when looking under rocks and logs. There are several morphotypes of the giant desert centipede, some of which have their own common name, such as the Texas red-headed centipede. But among the various morphotypes, this one is arguably the most iconic. These Sonoran desert centipedes cover a fairly large distribution, much of which is mesquite savanna, like the one that we're in right now. And they're usually encountered within 500 or 1,500 meters in altitude. Due to this wide distribution and altitudinal range that this morphotype occupies, it can be found in a variety of habitats, including but not limited to oak woodland and saguaro-dominated deserts. In the United States, these are split into roughly two main populations. Most of them are in the south-central population, mostly around Texas, and the other population exists mainly in Arizona. These two populations eventually converge in central Mexico. I think a beetle has stored ungulate crap under this rock here. You can see that there's a small little burrow over here, and I can actually see some movement inside the dirt. This actually smells way stronger than I could have ever expected. If I take a twig, I should just be able to poke it out. I doubt the burrow goes down very deep. And here it is. This looks to be a Canthon species of dung beetle. These beetles in the genus Canthon are known as dung rollers or tumble bugs. They are one of the groups of dung beetles that actually roll their dung, as their name suggests. Around here, they're almost strictly active during the monsoon season. I mean this for surface activity, but during other times of the year where it's still warm, these are mostly found in the ground. I want to say that this is Canthon imitator or Floridanus. I think one of those might be a synonym of the other, and I'm not really too sure on my identification, but there are several species that live in this area, most of which are black like this one. Large masses of dozens of these can be found on a single pile of dung. Unfortunately, I've never seen this. And I do know that they also feed on fallen prickly pear fruits, so perhaps they also feed on other fallen fruits. If I just put the beetle down here, it should be able to sense where it is right now.
and dig its way back into the dirt.
There was a big storm here recently, which is why I'm out here looking for these centipedes. And what's kind of interesting about the storms around here, or at least that one in particular, is it was just made up of a bunch of small, isolated storms, so not everywhere received rain. And I mean, a couple kilometers difference can mean that you're either searching dry rocks or ones that have some humidity left. And the latter are the ones where you can actually find centipedes. So you end up passing through a lot of habitat that is unsuitable, but you don't really know it until you start looking under the rocks, which is not so much the case earlier in the monsoon season.
Oh, nice. This is a black-necked garter snake. I'm gonna have to get out of the grass with two hands. Give me a second.
This is Thamnophis cryptopsis cryptopsis, and it's more specifically known as the western black-necked garter snake. This is a species that I've actually seen quite a few times in the past, but I still have not seen a single live adult. But this is arguably the most common garter snake species in Arizona, and if not, definitely the most common in the south. These inhabit quite a variety of habitats, usually somewhere near riparian, all the way from Utah to Guatemala. This subspecies specifically is only in the United States and northern Mexico, but it is possible to see these quite far away from water as well. So I mentioned that I haven't seen a single live adult of this species, but I have seen a dead one. This garter snake that I speak of was missing more or less half of its body. It was sitting in the water, but what was interesting is that there were Abetus water bugs that were feeding on it, two full-grown adults actually. There's a plains lubber grasshopper down here on the ground. And there's a second one that I saw somewhere over here. Oh yeah, there it is. Slightly larger, a little bit different in terms of colors. These are Brachystola magna, and their second common name is the homesteader. And I've actually been seeing hundreds of them around here, and I finally decided to record these two right here. Virtually all the ones in this area have some blue coloration on them, and this is not something that's necessarily uncommon in this species, but it isn't present in all of the populations. There are several species of Brachystola, but this is the only one that's found in the United States. I believe the rest are restricted to Mexico. These two that we have are adults, and you can see that they have brachypterous wings. This is a trait that's fairly common on grasshopper species that are lower to the ground, or fully terrestrial, but these wings are not vestigial. These do produce a little chirp that sounds something like this. And the generic name Brachystola might be in reference to this brachyptery, as it roughly translates to short robe. This is one of the heaviest insects in the area, and given the density that a population can attain, these are considered occasional pests of cotton. There are four recorded years of crop devastation by these insects in Texas from the 1950s to the late 70s. Here's our third one. This one seems to be even smaller than the last one that we found. And at this size, this is a common prey species for snakes in the genus Tantilla. Those are the centipede-eating snakes. They feed on other centipedes as well, but they've been well documented feeding on Scolopendra species, especially Scolopendra heroes. In this particular habitat, I don't see these centipede-eating snakes too often, but regionally, they are some of the more common snakes that you can find under rocks. At the time of recording this, we're practically at the end of the monsoon season. It's during this season that these centipedes are most active, but it should be noted that these centipedes have two activity periods in Arizona every year, the other one being during the springtime. But during that period, it can be much more difficult to find them, especially at night. During this monsoon season, individual nights that these are active are correlated with recent rains, meaning that it's easiest to find them right after a heavy rain. Their distribution is also correlated with where the monsoon hits during the summer. While these are a largely terrestrial species, they can still be found climbing up the trunks of trees, sometimes the sides of buildings, but much more often up steep rock cuts or ravines. Right over here, we have a California mantis on this stalk, and it is facing downwards. This is pretty much how I always find them. These California mantises are also known scientifically as Stagmomantis californica. Ironically, I've seen several in Arizona, but when I was living in California, I never saw more than a couple. Like the other stagmomantis species that live around here, these are variable in color, but the majority of the ones I've seen have been gray, like this one. The green ones, unlike these gray ones, lack any pattern. The vast majority of green stagmomantis in Arizona are Stagmomantis limbata. Those Arizona mantises are by far more common than these California mantises. And what's kind of interesting is that though these two species seem to occupy the same niche, these California mantises appear to be active later than Arizona mantises, by a good month or so. One random difference between these two mantises is that this one is far less adapted to metropolitan areas. The ratio of Arizona mantises to California mantises in urban areas is far greater than it is in nature. This is pretty much true for every single native mantis species in Arizona. You can see it's been acting quite defensively, and this has actually revealed a parasite attached to its wing. I actually don't know what kind of parasite this is, but it doesn't seem to be causing the mantis to be lethargic or anything. When I showed you that larger Diopharomera stick insect earlier, I also briefly showed you a smaller stick insect, and that was the Western Shorthorn stick insect. And what we're looking at right now is the same species, but this one obviously has quite a different color, being a kind of coral pink. I've stopped here to show you this one because it's actually the only one I've ever seen, and I've seen this species hundreds of times. Both mantises and Orthoptera are known for this genetic phenomenon where some of the individuals of some species are pink, but I don't think that's related to what we're looking at right now. I think it's quite possible that this is well within the range of variation for this species. On a similar note, I've noticed that the Acanalonia leafhoppers that are around here are either pink or green, not really any in between, and I think it's because they're mimicking petals and leaves, and the specific plant that they're most often found on has that same color scheme. Since we only found one adult, I thought we might try to find one out at night as well, so that is what we are doing now. And since everything was filmed during the day, about a week has passed. We do have a large desert centipede down here in the brush. Unfortunately, this one seems to be in a bit of a peculiar state. I was really hoping that I would see a healthy, large adult to show you what it's like to catch one when they are active. This one definitely seems to be a bit of an older individual. Let's see if it'll just crawl over my hand. Huh. This one is really sluggish. On the point of this centipede being a little bit on the sluggish side, you can also see that it has what seem to be some battle scars. It's missing half of a couple of its legs near the head here. This is most likely from an encounter with another animal, but it could have also lost them to an infection at some point. What's kind of funny is there's another animal out here that is orange and black, and perhaps more iconic than the centipede that we're looking at right now. I am, of course, talking about the Gila monster, Heloderma suspectum. I actually bumped into one about an hour ago while looking for this centipede. Sadly, I couldn't film it for very long because it headed straight into a bush. This Scolopendra heroes that we have does seem to be larger than the first one that we found during the day, by at least a couple centimeters. But I feel that I must reiterate, they can get even larger than the one that we have here, though I can't say that I've ever seen this. In fact, the one that we have here is the largest one that I have ever encountered. Just to avoid misleading my audience, I feel like I have to say, if you ever encounter one of these at night at this size, this is somewhat of a poor representation of how they might act when you handle them. That was kind of the whole point of trying to find one out at night, so in a way I kind of failed here. I guess now is as good of a time as any to mention that across practically all Scolopendra species, or centipedes in general, the larger an individual of a species is, the more mellow it'll be in general. It would be extremely difficult to find one of the smaller ones like we saw during the day that's anywhere near as sluggish as the one that we have here. All I can say is I hope that this one isn't on its way out soon. Right next to the centipede, there was this stick insect that I noticed a bit ago. Well, that will be all for this video of looking for giant desert centipedes in southern Arizona. So I hope you enjoyed, and thank you for watching.